You live in the quantum world, you take advantage of it every single day, and you don't even know what it means. In the morning, you wake up, you have a shower, you fry your eggs, toast your bread, brew your coffee, you brush your teeth, pack your laptop, take your phone, close the door, and run for the tram. That is 1 hour of your daily life sponsored by at least 1 million of scientific discoveries. I'm here as a quantum researcher to tell you why quantum mechanics is amazing and how quantum computers are going to change your lives. As scientists, we really try to explain the world. We want to explain the phenomena and the effects that we see around. We see that something is moving around and we want to predict its trajectory. Or we feel that something is like heating up or even bursting and we want to understand why this is happening. So all these things were already observed and explained long time ago. When I say long time ago, I'm talking like a few centuries. Those are the classics. So things like gravity, thermodynamics, maybe electromagnetism, they were explained long time ago. But human curiosity wanted to go a little bit farther. So humans are starting to look into the really small, tiny things. At some point, they found things like atoms, photons, or electrons, and they could no longer explain what was happening with these little particles using the set of laws that they were using for the bigger things. So they realized they needed a new set of laws. So in the 1920s, very important and renowned scientists like Schrödinger, Heisenberg, Bohr, came up with the first mathematical framework for quantum physics. And that was really revolutionary. Because from that moment on, we would distinguish the world into two different worlds. So we would have the set of laws that would explain the classical mechanics. And we would have also the set of laws that would explain the little things, the quantum particles. So actually, this was really a big thing, and it changed the whole thing. But I want to bring another differentiation here today. And this distinction is about what was told to us and what is untold to us. So let me try to explain this a little bit. When we are children, when we are at the school, we believe everything our teachers tell us. I'm not saying we shouldn't have. I'm not saying they were lying to us. I'm just saying whatever they would tell us, we would be like, well, cool. And so they would tell us about gravity. And if you really think about it, gravity, it's amazing. It's even unbelievable. There is like an imaginary, transparent, invisible force that is like pulling you down 24/7. And nobody questions it. Everybody is like, oh yeah, gravity, I've heard of it, yeah. But what about those things that we weren't told about? This is quantum physics. Because of that, because we never heard about it, because our teachers didn't tell us about it, we feel really disconnected to this world. We feel so disconnected, the only thing we know about it is that it's difficult to understand, counterintuitive, so we just don't even give it a try. But let me tell you something. If I can pretend to understand quantum physics, so can you. So nowadays, when we do research, we don't actually take a notebook, sit on a stone, and just look at the world pass by. We have a different approach. We try to implement everything in our laboratories. Or what is actually even lazier approach, we try to implement everything in our little computers. And this is kind of where we are stuck at the moment, because the calculations we want to do are not possible to be made in our classical computers, even in the classical supercomputers. So now, what is the concept of a computer? Let's start very basic. In any computer, what we need to do is to encode information in a system. In our computers, we call this system a bit. And to be a little bit scientific, a bit is a binary system. But it's just a technical word to say that it's a system that can be in two different states. Usually, we refer to it as 0 or 1. In reality, this is just a little transistor where we just apply a voltage or apply no voltage at all, and this is pretty much our 1 or 0. But now what happens when quantum mechanics wants to be like simulated in a normal computer? Well, quantum mechanics is beautiful. It's really gorgeous, believe me, but it is also a little bit complicated. And this is where our computers get stuck. There are many characteristics that make it really beautiful and really complicated, but there are two that I think are most important. One of them is quantum superposition, which means that a quantum particle is not in a defined state, but it can be in a superposition of two different states. And on the other hand, there is the quantum uncertainty, which means that we don't know the state of the particle until we measure it. So, okay, let's try to bring a little like hand-wavy example and see if we all understand it. Imagine I'm gonna toss a coin. It's still up there in the air until we get to the example. So basically, we have the coin flipping around, and while it is in the air, the state can be somewhere between heads and tails. So we can say it is in a superposition of heads and tails. And at the same time, while it is in the air, we don't know what the state is. However, when we catch the coin, we are sort of like making a measurement, we are making an observation, and we are disrupting the system. And at the same time, we are also defining the state of the coin, because it is no longer in a superposition, but it's going to be in zero or one, which is the same heads and tails, right? So now, I've said in normal computers, we just have a bit that can be in zero or one. But if we would have a quantum computer, we would have something that we call quantum bit, or what is the same, a qubit. In this case, it's not only in zero or one, but it is in zero and one at the same time. So now, let's imagine we have 20 particles. 20 is a very small number. Everybody can imagine 20 particles in a box if you want. And now this seems kind of easy. But what happens if every single particle can be in a superposition of two different states? Now you say, okay, it's 20, two different states. It cannot be that bad. But actually, if you want to consider the entire system, and if you want to consider every single possible combination, you would end up with more than a million combinations. And this is exactly where quantum computers are really beneficial and can boost the computing power, because our qubits can naturally be in a superposition of states, which means that they can naturally consider all the possible combinations at once. So now let's say I've convinced you, and fine, quantum computers are amazing, but how do we actually build them? So there are many different ways of building quantum computers. And basically, the main difference is the system in which we encode the information. So we can use photons, we can use atoms, we can use superconducting circuits. The only thing that matters is that all these systems can be in a superposition of two different states, zero and one. In my case, I worked with photons. I love their properties, they're gorgeous, but they are also a pain to work with. As many photons as we get from the sun, or as many photons as we can create in a laser system, these little bastards love punching with each other all the time. So actually, getting single photons one at a time is one of the major challenges that we have in photonic quantum computing. Believe it or not, I spent my entire PhD trying to get single photons using graphene. And we did quite some good steps forward, but it's still a long way to go. So there are other systems, as I said. Another one would be atoms. They have their own advantages, but they also have their own disadvantages. In the case of atoms, they get really distracted with everything that is around them. They like interacting with everything, all the fields around them. And because of that, it's very difficult to get them isolated. In the case of superconducting circuits, they also have their own advantages, but they also like being really cold. And when I say really cold, I'm talking colder than outer space. So this is certainly a big challenge in a laboratory. So what I'm trying to say is all the systems have their advantages and disadvantages. So basically, it's not clear who is going to win this race of quantum computing. But of course, like in any other competition, we need to define our criteria. How are you going to define who the winner is? So in quantum computing, we talk about something that is called quantum supremacy. And I thought, how am I going to explain quantum supremacy? And I thought, I'm just going to show them what Wikipedia says, because that's what we all do, don't we? So this is what Wikipedia says. In quantum computing, Quantum supremacy is the goal of demonstrating that a programmable quantum device can solve a problem that no classical computer can solve in any feasible amount of time. And the funny part comes in a little parenthesis that is right after, and it reads, irrespective of the usefulness of the problem. So actually, this may not make any sense to you, but it totally does. Because nowadays, every single quantum computer that is built with a specific purpose, with a specific purpose of solving one and only one problem. So basically, companies and research institutions, they're just looking for the problems that their quantum computers are good at. Then they compare the performance of the quantum computers with the classical computers. So whenever quantum computers are ridiculously faster than classical ones, we are talking about quantum supremacy. In 2019, Google presented the first quantum computer. It was based on superconducting circuits, and they got up to 53 qubits. And they claimed to solve one problem within 200 seconds, whereas the classical counterpart would have taken 10,000 years. So a year later, IBM actually claimed that this could have been solved within 2.5 days. But this is not the point of my talk, and none of the companies is paying me to advertise their products, so I'm just going to leave it there. The second and latest quantum computer was presented by the University of Science and Technology of China. This was this year. And this was based on photons. They got up to 76 qubits. They showed that they could compute a problem within 200 seconds, whereas the classical computer would have taken 2.5 billion years. So now if we really look at what they were solving, without offending anyone here, it was kind of useless. But don't get me wrong, this is what fundamental research is about. We make a little step forward, and it doesn't look like we're getting anywhere, but this step forward is so important to eventually get to the ultimate point. This is what research is about. So we shouldn't focus on what's the applicability of this exact step, but like, where is this taking us to? Because I'm pretty sure the first car was slower than bikes, and here we are nowadays with our fancy cars that can go way faster than what they are allowed to. So when I'm talking about the impact of like quantum computers, what is this about? What am I talking about? Am I talking about, I don't know, maybe Netflix not getting stuck when we're in the middle of the movie, or Tinder getting a little bit more efficient looking for matches, or maybe finally understanding the logic behind the price of the flights? Unfortunately, this is not what quantum computers are going to help us with. But there is something very, very important that they are going to help us with, and this is combinatorics. Before I said that because quantum particles, our qubits, can be naturally in a superposition of states, they are very good at looking into different combinations at once. So now imagine that you have a pile of pieces, and they tell you you can put them together in any way you want. And this is exactly what chemical and biological engineering is about. They have a bunch of atoms, the entire periodic table actually, and they can put them in any way they want to get the drugs with the properties that they are looking for. So now if you imagine like the billions and trillions of ways in which you can put atoms together, this is exactly where our classical computers are crashing, and this is exactly where quantum computers are going to really boost the computational power. Another very important point when we really consider different options is when we have to make decisions that consider many parameters at the same time, so you can have many combinations at the same time. And this is exactly what artificial intelligence is about. As humans, we are very good at considering the consequences of our acts, sometimes. But basically, when we want to make our robots, our machines, smarter somehow, we just want them to be able to look at different parameters, at different options, and give us the best one because they have gone through all of them. So hopefully, I have convinced you that quantum computing is amazing and that we should totally go for it. The question is, when is this going to happen? So unfortunately, I have no idea. And it's not because I didn't pay attention at university. It's because nobody knows. It could be a decade, 2 decades, half a century. To be honest, your guess is as good as mine. But there is something I know, and this is that it's gonna happen. Because in theory, we know how to build a quantum computer. The problem is that our technology is classical. It's very big, it's very rough, and basically we have to adapt all our machinery, all our technology, to be able to deal with these little quantum particles. So basically, one could say that it is just an engineering problem. Just. Thank you.